Sean Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you from my beautiful backyard garden here in July. Now we're going to do the July Q&A where you guys submit questions to me on my community tab, link down below. I will call through those questions and pick out a whole bunch and put them on the paper and answer those for you guys in this video. Now the cool thing about this episode is actually the last Q&A link down below to that one was filmed pretty much in the same spot where I just had gotten my okra planted out, probably just had got my peppers planted out. Now, you know, I have like tons of peppers on my plants. I don't know if you guys could see that. And I just did a whole round of harvesting, like lots of okra. I have like over, 30 okra plants easily. In any case, let's get into this month's questions. All right, first question is from Tosh. Did you ever get actual data analysis from Josh regarding the Boogie Frass? I knew you didn't want to vouch for it until you had proof it's effective. Just wondering if you did before I buy it. All right, Tosh. So Josh's Boogie Frass or Boogie Black product was never under my question. That's a completely legit product. That's basically the Black Frass from Intera up in Canada. Sold by a bunch of different companies. You know, the stuff I get is just from Josh. He imports like, I don't know, railroad cars full of the stuff. And has lots of it to sell. I like it. It works good. It's totally legit. Okay. Now the issue is the Boogie Humus. Now that one, from day one, I've always told Josh, I need some data on that. I want to see a food, you know, soil web test or earth fort test, whatever you want to call it. And he's never provided that to me. So while I do use his Boogie Humus, you know, I'm not gonna say buy that product for a fungal dominated compost because I don't know. I'm gonna say it's definitely a bacterial compost, probably got some fungal in there, but is the fungal levels high enough for you guys to order it and ship it across the United States? I wouldn't do it personally. It's quite unfortunate that humus or fungal dominated compost can be quite hard to find and is not available. I have been talking to Josh about bringing some in from Alaska. And I've told him where to get it and the source. And then that's how I work with him. I'm like, hey, Josh, this is a good product. Bring it in. And then it's up to him and the Boogie Boss to make it happen. And they haven't done that yet, so it's all good. I do like the Boogie Black. I add it to all my potting soil mixes. And when I top off my beds, I add it to the top off the beds. And I even add it a little bit to each planting hole. I believe it makes a difference for the nutrition of the plant and can reduce pest pressures due to the more active chitin that is available for your plants to uptake so that it could basically build its own defense systems. All right, next question is from Old Shield. You have not done a watering timer review in many years now. What, in your opinion, is a good, best multi-zone water timer? All right, Old Shield, that's a good question. You know, honestly, I haven't tested water timers in years since I made the videos. I mean, the reason is why? Because what I have works, and you know, while I do have to change them out every once in a while due to a bad valve, you know, because it kind of gets clogged up with like the hard water deposits I have here. Like, I like it, it works good, I'm familiar with it. And, you know, I kind of check in to see if there's any new products on the horizon that's going to work for me and what I specifically want. And, like, nobody's putting out any good, basically, I want a wired timer or it could be wireless but not need a constant internet connection. And I want it programmable and easily adjustable online. It's very important to me. And the Melnor water timer Wi-Fi, the Melnor Wi-Fi timer, it's a 4-port, is the one that I choose, and I have multiple of them to basically run my garden for the most part. I also have like a different box on the wall that I put, links down below if I remember, you know, that just has standard irrigation sprinklers, but I haven't really updated them because I haven't looked into that because what I have works, and if it ain't broke, don't fix it. All right. And the other thing is I haven't been to some of the trade shows that where they would show off the latest and greatest stuff because of the pandemic. All right. Next question is from Savannah Westmoreland. Hey, John, what's a simple homemade potting mix you would put together for a mixed variety of plants, mostly perennial, on a balcony in Houston, Texas? All right, Savannah, so I mean, I could tell you kind of what I would put in it, but the challenge is sourcing good local ingredients to basically make that recipe happen. I mean, here I always add in, you know, my compost that I make here. So like here when I make a potting mix, I usually try to have it make sure it gets good drainage because I don't want it like sticking up too much. So I use like perlite, I use some coconut coir, maybe some peat moss, my homemade compost, imported compost, worm castings, soil humates, rock dust. I'll use a bunch of different things, but here's the thing, you know, going out and buying all these things separately to put together a mix, not optimal, especially when you have such an amazing soil resource near you in Houston. So I'm gonna tell you, if you live anywhere in Houston, it is worth the drive to go up to, I think it's Conroe, Texas. It's a little bit, what, north of Houston. And you can look up Nature's Way Resources, link down below to that video. Nature's Way's got the best soil in Houston of all the places I've ever visited. Bar none, the dude knows what he's talking about. I trust him with my soil. I wish I could get his soil here because that'd be really needed. And he has different potting mixes, you know, a few different potting mixes that you may want to consider. And maybe even getting some of his potting mix and then mixing that with maybe a rose mix or a different other mix, depending on what you're growing, because he formulates some specifically. And actually, I would, you know, have you talk to him directly if you can, because he'll tell you what's up and he'll tell you exactly the best thing to do for your specific climate zone. And of course, he makes all the best soil right there on site, including that fungal dominated compost that can be very hard to find, or even just the leaf mold compost that is legit leaf mold compost. All right, next question is from Tony K. Those creepy green hornworms just ate my peppers last night. How do I prevent this? Depends how much you want to work. All right. So, you know, I used to get hornworms and they'd always affect pretty much my tomatoes and peppers. And so what I've done was I started putting out praying mantis egg sacks all around my yard in the springtime every year. I buy on eBay. They hatch, and then the praying mantises, as they grow up, if they find small little hornworms, like the little worms when they're like that big, they will eat them. I've seen them eat them. I probably have an Instagram post where I'm showing you guys praying mantis eating a hornworm. So they will be your control for you so that you don't have to do all the work, right? Number one. Now, if the hornworms get too big because you don't have enough praying mantises or they don't find them, then I guess it's called, then you could use a spray. If you want to do a spray, you could do an organic spray called BT that'll kill those kind of worms, caterpillar-like things. That being said, I don't like to use BT on my crops unless absolutely necessary, because that may negatively affect our microbiome. But, you know, I'm also overly careful on that. So, I mean, the preferred method is go out with a black light at night when it's completely dark and just shine it all on your plants. And then the hornworms will light up and then you got to pick them off. So you got to go out there, you know, maybe a couple times a night sometimes to just make sure you get them all. And the other thing is when you're walking your garden every morning, because I know you're out in your garden every morning checking it out and making sure everything's growing well, look for the little grenades on the ground or the edges of your raised bed or your soil. I mean, when I'm walking around, I'm like looking for like, okay, what little small things changed today that's different than yesterday? And if I see those little grenades, then I like look up from where the grenades are because that's their poop. And then I find the hornworm and I take care of that little sucker. All right. So that's what I'd say to you. All right, next question is from an earthy artist. Fennel, I'd like to learn more about why some say it shouldn't be planted near other crops due to being allelopathic. And is there some way to grow it so it won't negatively affect my other plants? I have 6 4x12x12 wood raised beds in my backyard and a small suburban property at my home. Please excuse me if you've already covered this topic. Thanks. All right, so actually I haven't covered this topic. Fennel is one of my favorite plants. I grow the bronze fennel because it has that, you know, the kind of brownish color, more nutrition. Also, it's a lot stronger flavored. And to be honest, I don't really grow fennel purposely. I grew it like once and then it just goes to seed. It drops tons of seeds and they come up everywhere. They'll come up next to peppers. They'll grow next to my yacon. You know, they grow next to all my different crops that I'm aware of. Maybe there's some that aren't going to grow next to the fennel, and this I'm growing a wild fennel versus a cultivated, you know, fennel. So like, I wouldn't really be worried about it. You know, if you have special plants you want to make sure grow, you know, grow that in a different bed than your fennel, since you got like four beds. The other thing, or six beds, the other thing I would do is I would make it in its own bed, or like another area of your yard where you could just grow fennel, because if you let it go to seed, it'll drop seeds. And for me, it just like literally grows as a weed, and fennel has long tap roots, and it's really minimally affected by drought conditions or stress because of that tap root. And to pull them up, because I try to pull them up a lot, they're hard to pull up because the tap root goes down real deep. So, you know, I would not really worry about it personally, but I didn't go to school for botany or anything. I just kind of see what happens in my garden, and stuff grows next to fennel all the time. So that's all I know. Next question is Noah Green. John, I've watched you for years and work on an organic veggie farm in Citra, Florida. Thanks in part to your recommendation. We have lots of new greens and food crops on the farm. I'm adding perennial kale this fall, and I was wondering what are your recommendations are for keeping it healthy through the brutal summer heat and almost constant rain in our climate here. Do you know of anyone growing tree kale in Florida successfully? I want to invite you out to Cronies Cradle Conserve if you've ever out here again. Keep on growing. All right, thanks. No, yeah, I rarely ever get up to the Citra, Florida area. I had to look that up. Actually, it's like above north of Orlando a bit. Looks like an amazing area, and actually I like that it's not super south, so that's actually probably working to you in your favor. You're going to get cool weather in the winter, gonna be nice and warm, but not too warm in the summertime, and I tree collard should do fairly well. It is a more humid environment. I mean, I have it here in my arid desert climate. Today was like pushing 110 degrees, and this is what I've noticed about the tree kale, or tree collards, whatever you want to call them, because I use the words interchangeably, but they're not. So some years I like would put reflective shade cloth on it. Like I think I did that for like 2 years, and then they like thrive better. They grew more. They were more productive in the summertime. And when I don't put the shade cloth on them, you know, they don't grow quite as quickly, but that depends. That's the ones over here. I have ones over there that just are in full sun year round. Provided they get enough water, they grow great. Now, the other thing I learned was by accident, because when I was on vacation one time, my irrigation system broke. And it broke in the on position, so my backyard was like flooded, and it basically gave 24-hour water for the tree collards for probably at least a week or so, and those things grew like crazy, like mad. So provided you have good draining soil, and you know, you don't have any funky nematodes or funky bugs or things in your garden, your farm, it should grow well. Like, so I would say make sure you keep it well watered. You know, good draining soil that's not going to hold too much water, especially if you're raining a lot. You want to get the water away. I mean, the soil I have here drained really well, even though it was on constant water. I mean, that's what I'd say to you. And I would say work your microclimates, you know. So get a couple different cuttings, or if you have, you know, one plant, they'll let it grow up and then take cuttings from it. And then start planting it in different areas of the farm, of your yard, wherever you're going to grow it. Plant one in the shade next to the house where it's more protective. Plant one in full sun. Plant one over here where it's next to the tree or whatever. Plant in different areas so then you could like see how it's gonna work. And you know, one of those, I will guarantee you, will grow better than the others. I don't know which one because I'm not where you are. And hey, report back. Let me know what you find out. And if I'm ever in the area, I'll definitely come and visit. All right, next question is from Tony Gaming. Hey John, my question is, do you still believe that Dr. Earth is still one of the best fertilizer that people could buy? All right, Tony, so I will definitely say that Dr. Earth is one of the best fertilizers that you could buy at a big box store or at your local nursery. A lot of fertilizers are regional. I have not investigated all of them, but Dr. Earth, I mean, I met Milo Seamus, link down below that video if I remember, you know, at a trade show. We talked, and I mean, the dude is legit. I mean, I'm going to say the dude is legit. Are there better fertilizers that you could find from some small, you know, guy that's working out of his garage? Absolutely. There's a few of those that I may have videos on in the future. And probably, you know, I've included those in some videos in the past. But for something being widely available, yes, Dr. Earth is still the best fertilizer that you could find. I mean, I think even Home Depot these days sells it. Next question is from Irish Pride. I live in Vermont and was wondering how to go about keeping a living soil going through the winter. Thank you. All right, living soil in the winter, so you could put up like hoop houses to keep your soil warm, but you probably can't do that on your whole farm. So what I would do is a second alternative is I would massively mulch with leaves. You know, I visited a guy up in Canada where snow is up in the wintertime. I mean, literally he put leaves like this deep on his growing beds. And I mean, so just stack them up. Leaves will act like the insulation in the walls of your house so your house don't get cold in the winter. You want to insulate your soil with all the leaves. It'll basically keep the soil warm, so keep it alive. You could keep roots in the soil even better, so grow carrots in the right before it's going to frost. Actually plant them about now so that they'll be in the ground when it snows. And oh, before it snows, then you're going to put the leaves down, so the roots will still be in the ground, still like living and stuff. And you could dig them up if you need to, put the leaves on the top, and just let it go in the winter time. And the leaves will break down over time, build your soil. You'll be creating a more living, fertile soil because you are covering the soil, and actually you have roots in the ground over the winter time. And if you don't want to grow carrots, grow other some kind of root that's going to stay in the ground over the winter time, and then, you know, come back the following year. Or that you could harvest. All right, next question is from Matt Stalford. What are your thoughts on Korean natural farming, such as using fermented plant juice, FPJ from comfrey leaves, and collecting indigenous microorganisms, IMOs? I live and grow in Vegas as well, and I'm looking for the best organic ways to increase the health of the soil food web in my garden. Have you ever harvested local forest humus from nearby forests to add to the soil in your garden as well? All right, Matt, so yes, I agree with Korean natural farming principles, absolutely. I wanna visit a Korean natural farm over in Hawaii one of these days when I get back to Hawaii. It's been on my to-do list for a while now. I think fermented plant juices and IMOs are amazing, and you should try to, you know, cultivate those. That being said, you know, a lot of people using specific farming techniques such as Korean natural farming may just believe in their techniques and just like, this is the best, and have blinders on, and I'm not gonna do anything else. You know, I would not have that frame of mind. I would wanna do Korean natural farming techniques and then also use other techniques and other ways to build the food soil web in your garden, such as like I spray on, you know, microbes in a package that are sourced from around the world that may not be already existing, you know, indigenously in this area for the best results. I use compost tea sourced from compost. It's not from the local area either. You know, so I do a host of things, and I encourage you guys always to have a broader mind, because, you know, what I've learned in gardening and just in life in general, the more diversity, the better. And I have not been to local forests, which are USDA, so probably removing soil from forests is probably a crime. So I have not done that. And the other thing is the forests in the local area are a little bit at a different elevation and a different climatic situation. So should you bring some soil from a local forest that's not in the valley of the desert, then you're going to have a different microclimate. And then maybe those microbes that are living in the forest won't live where you live because it's just a totally different environment. Maybe some will stay, but, you know, I don't know. I always kind of wonder about that. But I definitely agree that it could not hurt, or maybe even brew them into compost tea and then spray them out. That'd probably be the best thing to multiply the microbes. All right, next question is from Bonnie Shelley. Hi, John. What do you do with your materials after you make compost teas? I have a 3-bin compost system that I use to top dress, but I purchased Boogie Brew goods from Josh and would like to hear your thoughts about your personal experience for those of us who dipping our toes in aerobic teas. Thank you. All right, Bonnie. So when I brew my tea, I brew like, it's like 2 to 3 cups of Boogie Brew tea that I use to brew every time. Plus I might add some extra worm castings in. I have that mash that's in the tea strainer at the end of my brew. What do I do with it? So I scoop it out, and then that stuff I consider like just really ultra rich compost. It's kind of been seeped out, leached out a little bit. So then I put that underneath, like just layered on top, like top dress my favorite plants. So if you're one of my favorite plants, you know, you're going to get that top dressing. This year I topped my edible hibiscus with it, as well as maybe the moringa tree and other certain select, lemon. You know, I top certain plants with it, so like every plant would just get a small little circling right around the root zone. A lot of the plants that I just had put in get it. Like if I want the plant to do well, like, okay, let's just put it there. So, I mean, that's what I do personally. Sometimes I just, like, mix it up with water and then just water it into, like, other potted plants or water it into a raised bed as well. All right, next question is from Moore Barris. What concerns should someone have when trying to use raised off-the-ground planters compared to gardening in the soil? So, I mean, there's a few things that people should consider when kind of trying to grow off the ground than actually in the ground. Of course, I always encourage you guys to grow in the ground because that's how nature does it. And we could do things off the ground. If you need something high because you can't bend over, I would build something high but have it connected to the ground. So number one, you should consider grounding. I mean, that's kind of far-fetched for some people, but all the plants that are in the ground are grounded. And if you're using a plastic pot, for example, to grow above the ground, even just with a bottom on it, your pot may not be grounded and your plants may not grow as well. You know, I mean, I've seen some studies on that. Number two, you definitely want to pay attention to your soil mixture. You know, if you're connected to the soil, things are going to be more easily regulated. And when you're off the soil, things are not going to be easily as regulated. So for example, the soil in an, you know, a raised bed that's not touching the ground, air could blow underneath it like bridges. You know, you ever see those signs when you go over a bridge, it says bridge may be icy. And that's when it's in the winter because the air whips through there. The bridge gets really cold and it could freeze the water on the road. So you could slide, but it's only across the bridge because the roads on either side are fine. So the same thing happens in a raised bed or elevated bed that's not connected to the ground. Not that it's going to get extra cold in the winter because you probably won't be growing in the winter, but in the summertime, air could rush through there. Things could dry out a lot faster. You also might want to worry about runoff and like plan for, you know, when I water it, if there's extra water, is that going to drip through and then drip on the patio that it's on or drip on the carport, or I don't know if you're growing inside or where you're putting it. You got to make sure, you know, you pay attention where the runoff is going to go. That's why I like the ground. You water in the ground, it's just going to go into the ground, affect the microbes in the ground, and end up back in the water table if you overwater, I guess. The other thing you may want to consider is also the microclimate of, you know, the raised planter box that you're making. You know, where will you place it? How much sun is it going to hit? Is it just going to get fried in the sun? Like, I would not do a raised planter box here unless it was maybe a self-watering box. It just doesn't make sense to me. I may set up one of those here actually pretty soon and make a video about it. Not really sure. But yeah, I mean, just think long and hard before you make a planter bed that's raised above the ground, not connected to the ground. You know, I'd encourage you guys always to connect it to the ground if you are able. All right, next question is from David Farrell. If you are starting a business in Orlando, Florida, growing dandelions to use and create a business selling the leaves, roots, flowers, juice, dehydrating, freeze-drying, making teas, etc., how would you get started and what is the part with the most demand and or profit? Would you go with dirt or hydro aeroponics? Thanks in advance for your answer. All right, David, so the honest thing I would do first is, I mean, number one, I'd grow in soil. Dandelions have tap roots. Number two thing I do is I would try to like use other people's property to grow dandelions personally. And I mean, dandelions are a weed. Probably the one thing I'd do is I'd go out to like land where there's like no occupied land or nobody on the land. If you could do this and just dump dandelion seeds everywhere and just let them grow naturally because you don't have to take care of them. And then go back and just harvest them and dig them up, right? I mean, it probably rains enough there in Orlando to make that happen. People probably have dandelions coming out of their lawn. So, I mean, that'd be my approach. I'd want to just grow them in soil, get them growing, and I would need to assess, honestly, like, I don't know where the money is in dandelions. I think it's amazing that you want to do that because dandelions are a very potent food. People do not recognize this. The dandelion greens are good for detoxification of the liver and all different parts of the plants, including the little stems of the flowers that are hollow. You could use the straw or you could eat them. The flowers are edible. I mean, it's one amazing plant. I think it's cool that you want to dehydrate, freeze dry, make teas and all these things. You know, probably I'd start off first with like just the easiest thing is dehydration. Dehydrators are cheap. Start selling at a local farmer's market. I think the biggest part for you is doing education and also get a website up. You'll be able to sell like locally grown dandelion teas because that's probably more acceptable to a lot of people. And then maybe even like do fresh dandelion green juice at the farmer's market, like shots. That's badass. All right. Good luck, man. All right. Down to last few more questions here. Thee 990-999-0990. All right. Hi, John. I'm making my first outdoor garden now. I am finding a lot of rocks in my soil. I will eventually make all the beds raised and won't have to worry. My question is, are there any vegetables, particularly root vegetables, that can be affected negatively by rocks? Thanks, man. All right, so the main issue is if the root comes and hits a rock, then the root's gonna come down and then it's gonna not like the rock and it's gonna try to grow a different direction or may get stunted. So any kind of root vegetables could be prone to rock damage. I mean, long carrots are more problematic than growing like some thumbelina carrots that are like nice and short and small, because you're probably not gonna have problems with those. But then I guess the only issue really with them is that you're gonna get some deformed carrots that might look really funny, and if you're trying to sell them, you know, the people aren't gonna buy funky carrots. I mean, if you're just eating them yourself, it doesn't really matter. I mean, of course, if there's big ass large boulders in your ground, you know, you might wanna remove the larger stuff. That being said, you know, having some rocks in the ground could be a good thing for aeration. I mean, I have plenty of rocks in my ground here, you know, that are below my raised beds. I come across them every once in a while, and you know what? It's just what it is. Don't be too paranoid about it. Don't like go through and try to like waste a whole day and picking out all the rocks. I wouldn't necessarily do that. But yeah, do build some raised beds when you can. And, you know, start off with one raised bed and just grow the root vegetables in there and grow all the other stuff in the area that still has the rocks. And it's fine. And just make sure you top off that soil, add good compost and other amendments, and you'll be good. All right, cool. Next question is from Robert Evans. Hey, John, I've read that apple seeds contain a small amount of cyanide and should not be processed through my juicer because it's unhealthy, especially if you juice a lot of apples on a daily basis as part of a daily juice recipe. I've since started to cut apples in half and use a grapefruit spoon to core out the middle section where the seeds are. What are your thoughts on this? All right, Robert, so personally, I don't ever remove my apple seeds because of the potential toxin in there. It is true they contain toxins. If you ate, you know, a couple hundred apple seeds, you could probably die. But the other thing is this, you know, our bodies can naturally detox, depending on, you know, if you're healthy or not, can detoxify some amount of cyanide from the apple seeds without issue. And in some cases, I mean, some of these compounds in plants have hormetic effects. You could look that up. That basically means that if it don't kill you, it makes you stronger. Don't take that out of context. I'm not saying eat tons of apple seeds, but if you're just throwing apples in a juicer and you drink the juice, depending on your juicer, some juicers are very inefficient at breaking open apple seeds and extracting the nutrients out. So I don't know what juice you're using. So look at the juicer, man. If the juicer's spitting out whole apple seeds without crushing them up, I mean, I would say there's less risk. Of course, do what you feel is right. If you feel comfortable removing the seeds, then remove them. I'm not ever going to tell you what to do. I'll tell you what I do is that unless the little part of the middle of the apple has like mold or some funky growth in it, I leave the seeds and I juice them all through my juicer. Actually, there was a study I reviewed that said the middle core of the apple actually has the most, I guess, probiotics in there compared to the other parts, because I mean, things could get in that little hole in the bottom and in the little stem end. So I mean, I want to get that stuff into me, provided they're hopefully good microbes. So yeah, you know, and then I purposely save apricot kernels, which also has the cyanide in there, and I do eat a few of those a day. And I believe them to be beneficial. Once again, you know, if you look up Laetril B17, it's supposedly an anti-cancer treatment that some people have claimed. You know, I believe, once again, in small amounts, certain plant foods are good. Now, the other thing is I don't drink apple juice every day either. And I would encourage you, if you are drinking a recipe with apples in it every day, I would encourage you to switch your recipes up. As good as you're getting a lot of nutrients from apples, and apple skins are quite beneficial for probably some of the polyphenols that feed our beneficial gut buddies, you know, I encourage you guys to juice a diversity of different foods and always changing it up based on what's in season in your area and the fruits in season. You know, so use different fruits instead of just apples. Sometimes maybe omit the apples and add more cucumber or add some more celery, or I don't know exactly your recipe. So, you know, that's my answer to that. Juice a diversity of things. Try to always change your recipes up. And if you do so, and you're not eating apples all the time, I personally don't worry about it. All right. Next question is from Ian L. It's been a while since you did an episode featuring Josh on the Hudson Fogger. Do you still consider that tool to be a good one? I have a high density urban backyard with a lot of trees and a lot of citrus trees, and of course they get the horrible Asian leaf miner pest. So I have wondered whether blasting the trees like Josh did in that video and using the same concoction would be something you might recommend today. Alrighty, and so in that video, Josh used the Hudson Fogger machine with a neem oil and Dr. Bronner's salsa soap. I still use that recipe on a very restricted and limited basis these days, as much as it is an organic solution and a fairly lower toxic organic solution, which I do like because it's based on neem oil. You know, it's not my go-to because neem oil can also negatively impact pollinators and beneficial insects in your garden. Of course, you know, you have to take things into context and see kind of what pest you have and see, you know, what are some other alternatives you could do before you spray out the neem. I haven't usually sprayed neem in a while. I mean, lately I've had some white fly issues and some aphid issues, and when that happens, I just spray high pressure water. And I'm about to bust out the Dr. Zymes, which is a non-systemic, you know, pesticide that like disappears in just a few hours. So it's not going to affect pollinators. But it, you know, it depends on you and your specific situation. Of course, my first goal is to always increase the health of the plants so that they could create their own defense systems. Maybe even get some beneficial insects that are going to take care of the bad insects. So that you don't have to do all the work, right? And if the plants are so healthy so that they produce all their secondary plant metabolites and make their own defense systems, right, that makes your job a lot easier. So work on really building your soil and maybe spraying your plants down with extra amendments, whether that is, I don't know, phytoplankton and kelp or trace minerals, you know, maybe some chitin or using the Boogie Black, the Frass. You know, these things may help bring your defenses of your plants up so that you don't have to spray. Of course, if you need to spray, you could spray the neem and Dr. Bronner. I still do use that very limited today. That being said, I do not recommend the Hudson Fogger. I had other videos about this. I don't recommend the Hudson Fogger. It's a POS. The thing rusted out on me. I contacted Hudson. They didn't even respond to me. So I have an upcoming episode where I'm showing a really cool backpack fogger that I now have. And I'll be doing a review on that hopefully pretty soon, because I'm going to have to like do that video when I spray out my Dr. Zymes on my plants for the white flies and the aphids. That thing's bomb. Yeah, I love my backpack fogger now. All right, next question is from Norman Schertzman. At Las Vegas Garden House, do you have shade cloth over your entire garden in June and July? What kind and at what height? All right, Norman, so it's currently July. June has passed. No shade cloth is up in my garden. I think a few years I did put up EMT conduit that's 10 feet tall because that's the lengths that they came in, and I didn't bother to cut them. Or maybe I did cut them a little bit. So it actually reached the height of the structure I have in my garden. I mean, it is probably still about 10 feet tall. And no shade cloth. So, I mean, I have used shade cloth in the past, but, you know, for me, shade cloth was kind of mostly a pain in the butt. Putting it up, taking it down. Blowing, and then the one that I used, it's a reflective shade cloth that starts to flake, so it's just too problematic. As you see, I'm in my garden, full sun, no problem. Just make sure you water enough. You know, shade cloth can maybe reduce the temperature in your garden for your plants, reduce the sunlight, can reduce the pollination, you know, and the plant growth, but it can protect your plants. And then also, it may reduce your water needs. That being said, my goal is to get as much photosynthesis to my plants as possible so they could grow the most and provide them enough water so that they could do so. So yeah, no shade cloth. I do not anticipate putting any shade cloth up over my garden this year. And when I did put up shade cloth, it was only ever up half on half of my garden, this side of my garden. My other side with the round circular beds, never got shade cloth because I have no infrastructure to put them up over there. And it always grows fine. And my tests from when I did put up shade cloth showed that the areas with the shade cloth, aside from my tree collards, it grew better. All my fruiting crops, like peppers and whatnot, didn't grow as well because they weren't getting as much sunlight. All right, last question is from Angel. Hello, I'm 22 and I've just bought a house, and I like to start a tiny indoor herb garden for the ones I use often. Thyme, basil, parsley, lavender, mint, etc. Do you have any pointers on soil to use, good placement for the herbs in my home, or what time to plant things? All right, Angel. Well, first, congratulations on buying a home. Second, I hope you are planning out putting some raised beds out back, because growing outside, in my opinion, is a lot easier than growing inside. Now, if you do want to grow inside, you know, I'm going to take your question and give you a little bit different answer than what you said, because I wanted to make it easy for you to grow and be successful gardening, so you'll catch the gardening bug and be like, wow, I grow my own herbs, and now I'm going to start an outside garden like John said, because I want to even grow more stuff, right? And the easiest way to grow herbs, and this is not a paid sponsorship or nothing like that, use an aero garden. I gave an aero garden to my ex-girlfriend when we were together, and she used it, and she was so successful growing herbs, and she got excited about growing. Of course, after that, she was not excited about growing, especially after she moved in with me and she has a full garden. She would barely ever help me in the garden, which was sad. But anyways, buy an aero garden and get an herb kit. You could select what herbs you want to grow in there. They have a lot of different herbs, including all the basils. And guess what? When using an aero garden, you're growing it inside, and it has its own lighting system. You could start it any time of year. It's also inside, so you have air conditioning in your house probably, and the temperature is more regulated. So yeah, whenever you want to grow, you can grow in an aero garden indoors. You don't have to worry about the sunlight, because the LED lighting comes on automatically, goes off automatically. You just make sure it's filled with water. They got all the little fertilizer stuff, the liquid you put in there, and it just grows. Super simple, super easy. That's what I'm going to recommend for you, so you get to get started and be successful. And if you want more than just one aero garden, because they have ones that have 6 spots, they have one with 9, and maybe they even have ones that have more spots than that, right? Get a second one and grow more, right? But yeah, that's an excellent way to grow herbs. Super simple, super easy, and you will be successful. So that's it for this month's Q&A. If you guys enjoyed this Q&A, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Make sure you leave a comment down below. That helps out the YouTube algorithm get this video out to more people. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else you think it can help. And also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that come in every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bells to get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.